powers that we don't want to change it because they want more people in ill health. Then only they can say, we will have garibi hatao. They have been garibi hataoing for a long time. But if the garibi is really hataoed, who will vote for them? So they want, in a sense, garibi to continue. They want malnutrition to continue. They want ill health to continue. Otherwise, how can hospitals thrive? If everybody becomes sick, where's the need for a hospital? I was telling doctors, if you are a doctor, become a gynecologist. Because even if everybody becomes healthy, still, you know, procreation will continue. If you are in business, be a restaurant. Because anything happens, you want to eat. Without eating, you can't survive. So these two businesses, you don't have to monger. Otherwise, if I'm a doctor, so if I'm a cardiologist, and I want to do angiograms, I want everybody to have a block. Mark Twain once said, for a man with a hammer in the hand and itching to use it, everything in this universe looks like a nail needing hammering. Somebody the other day was telling me a nice story. I must tell you that. I must get it out of my chest before I forget it. Heart attack in the shop. Oh, I know what I was doing. I was playing with the switch. That's why on and off it is going. What a fool I am. See, playing with the switch. So, man had a heart attack. He became unconscious. He was taken to the nearby hospital, let us say, X hospital. And they treated him, etc., etc. On the third day, he started opening his eyes. This was a charitable hospital. Charitable hospitals, do you know today? Charitable hospital is a hospital which gets all the tax rebates from the government and charges extra for the patients. Now anyway, this was a charitable hospital run by nuns. Now there is a nun sitting by the side and saying, what is your name? He told his name. Where do you come from? He said, do you have any relatives? He said, no, except one sister. Do you have insurance? He said, no, I don't know what insurance is. Do you have a job? He said, I don't have a job. Are you under the care of the government? I said, no, I don't have anything with the government. Then who will pay your bill? It is already 4 lakhs. He said, I don't know. Then he said, you have a sister, what's she doing? She is a sister, she is a nun. And she is a spinster. He said, the sister suddenly grew serious. And she said, nuns are not spinsters. They are all married to God. Then fine, sister, send the bill to my brother-in-law. So today you must, God as your brother-in-law, if you fall sick and go to a hospital. To change that, I started this concept called wellness concept, about which I have been writing for 25 years now, where I said, A, we are all born with an inbuilt doctor, whom I call as the internal healer, which we call as the immune system, which you respect from day one. Number one, how do you respect? You drink your mother's milk as long as you can. As long as you can. And don't drink milk at all. Because it's foreign protein, it will destroy you. If you want to take any milk if you don't have a mother, you can denature the milk and make it curds. And that too, make it ghee. Gritham tejasvinam pitta anilaharam rasa saujasam, says Ayurveda. Ghee is pure butyric acid, caprionic acid and a few other fatty acids. No protein at all. Protein is that dark soup that comes out when you clarify butter. And then you eat food as given by nature. Not, you know, changing food to taste the soup, the as given by nature. And I was surprised, you know, people were saying coconut oil is a poison and should not. I said, look, what is this you're talking about? They said coconut oil has cholesterol. Of course, if a doctor says coconut oil has cholesterol, he has not gone to the medical college at all. Because the first thing we teach in biochemistry is cholesterol comes from an animal source. How can vegetarian think of cholesterol? Then they realized that they started changing it. Coconut oil is saturated fat. Others are non-saturated fat. So saturated fat is bad. This is called the jati system, how to divide people in, you know, you are a Brahmin, you are a Shudra, you are this, you are that. That doesn't exist. What is the fatty acid in coconut oil is the question. What is the fatty acid in mother's milk is the question. They are the same. Both are sodium monolaurate. Sodium monolaurate is monolauric acid, which is the basis of the human immune system. So if you don't have a mother's milk, If you have to have food, even in America, the infant food has the base of coconut oil. Now Americans are saying, we are sorry, by doing propaganda against coconut oil, we have killed millions of people in the world. Coconut oil is a treatment. And the latest thing is, coconut oil is a treatment for Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's disease. Because coconut oil gets digested in the mouth itself. It doesn't have to go to the gut. Only two things get digested in the mouth, coconut oil and mother milk. And that's why an infant can't take any other oil, because it doesn't have pancreatic lipase at that age, in the first year. So mother's milk and coconut oil get digested. Now coconut oil gets digested in the mouth and gets converted into ketones. And a brain cell which is damaged can live on ketones but not on glucose. That is why Alzheimer's disease, people lose their memory because brain cells die. Now if you take coconut oil, brain cells don't die, and even if they are dying, they will get rejuvenated. And there are reports of patients being treated with Alzheimer's disease with coconut oil. So take nature's, you know, why is coconut there? It's called Kalpa Vriksha. What is Kalpa? Not even a century. Not even all the centuries. Not even Dreta Yuga. All times to come. It's a Kalpa, the whole thing. Vriksha. The only thing. Tell me one part of coconut tree which is not useful. Which is not biodegradable. Have you seen Kerala girls? Have you seen any Kerala girl who is in Kerala using what they use? Dandruff? You can't have dandruff. Have you seen a Kerala girl having any skin disease? You can't have it. Even the serious skin diseases I have treated with coconut oil. One of my colleagues is a professor of neurology, had a peculiar infection in his thigh. And I said, look, apply a little coconut oil, I say, it will go. He said, what are you talking? You know, I am a scientist. I don't think it's coconut oil, you know, and the smell, I don't like it now. He said, okay, he went to the dermatologist who was our student. That fellow said, sir, we'll do a biopsy. He did a biopsy. Biopsy showed nothing, but this whole thing got infected. The whole thing became pus. And at that stage, he was crying. Then I said, look, even now coconut oil will help you. And coconut oil helped him. Completely gone. I got photographs. Then he said, ah, you're a good thing. I am a patient. You report this case. I said, fine. After about a month, I said, I am reporting this case. Now give me permission. He said, oh, no, no, no. I don't like that coconut oil. I've forgotten about it. His thing is gone. See, this is our attitude. This is our attitude which I don't like. I am a scientist. I said, what is a scientist? A scientist is an inquirer. Science is a method to find out how nature works. Science is not what Marie Curie said. Science is measurement. Measurement is science. If that is so, medicine is not science at all, because it all depends on your thought. Can I measure your thought? Can I measure your thought? No. Can I see you now? Do you exist? I don't know. You exist because I see you. If I don't see you, you don't measure. So where is science? So science is, medicine needs a new science called the holistic science. And there are various methods of helping the inside healer, which can be homeopathy, umapathy, Ayurveda, modern medicine, etc., etc. Provided it doesn't harm you. This sentence, one sentence you remember, except for corrective surgery, supposing you are born with a hole in the heart, it has to be corrected, nothing will correct it. Because that hole was supposed closed when you are born, for some reason it was not closed. It's also our mistake only. Probably you get born in a different way. Instead of you coming through difficult thing and crying, we pulled you out easily. And then, you know, say, you know the story? A butterfly has to come out of its cocoon, the worm. And it takes days to come out. One day a child saw that and told the father, I believe, it struggled. I'm going to break it so that it come out. So he broke it. The worm could. But because it has to come out through that, so delivery is not at all there. They say, child, what is it? Fetal distress, cesarean. Doctor distress, he has to go for a wedding, he can't wait whether she will deliver or not. So, cesarean. Bombay, I was told 90% cesarean at one stage. Now in New York, they allow people to deliver normally. That's what's called normal birthing. When you become pregnant, you take your husband and yourself to that normal starting lady who is not even a doctor. They give you education. 99.99% of them deliver normal. That's why one of our professors who wrote the first textbook, British Indian textbook, Lakshman Swamudelia, had this formula in the book. He wrote, masterly inactivity but watchful expectancy is obstetrics. Today, masterly inactivity and quick delivery is our formula. Because today we want money. Normal delivery, how much money you get? Everybody at least a cut, which is called episiotomy. Studies have an episiotomy does not heal well, but a normal tear, if it happens, heals very well. A normal tear gives the pelvis a good, strong pelvis. An episiotomy leaves it very weak. Now, if you allow the child to come through that, that's also a development of the mind. It is called perinatal consciousness. There is a prenatal consciousness in the stomach, womb, perinatal consciousness, and then postnatal consciousness. Perinatal consciousness, I tell you, supposing the child wants to come out, stage, for some reason, either the doctor or the drug delays that. Child wants to breathe, but can't breathe. It gets that suffocating imprinted in his mind. These are the people who get asthma later on in life. It's all in your consciousness. You get born when your cells, individual cells, get the message from the universal consciousness through the wall, which I call as magic brain. The brain is in each cell. Membrane is the cover. I call it as membrane. You can see in the internet, magical membrane. Now it's like a television set. I was telling the Hinduja people this morning, you switch on your television, let us say Amitabh Bachchan or Shah Rukh dancing. Then your wife calls you for dinner, you switch off the television. Both Amitabh Bachchan and Shah Rukh Khan have died. But you go to the dinner room and your wife has a television there, on the same channel, they come alive again. Human be that. When you get the message from the universal consciousness, of which you are an individual consciousness, get the message, you become alive. Okay? But like Amitabh Bachchan and Shah Rukh Khan, you are not there inside the television. You are in the consciousness. Remember that? The Amitabh Bachchan is not in the television set, only the energy wave set. You are not alive, but the energy wave is, you are a part of the consciousness. You are a whole. Purnamidam, Purnamadaha. Purnasya, Purnamadaha, Purnamaveshishtate. If you take a bit from the whole remains a whole bit. On this principle today, Rustum Roy has been able to now get atomic hydrogen from, not molecular hydrogen, which any chemistry lab, it will leave nascent oxygen, which will destroy a engine. Now you get atomic hydrogen. So, hydrogen becomes hydrogen, water. So that you can put water in your car and run it, inshallah. And then you don't buy anything. You just buy water, especially in Bombay, very easy, because salt water is better than ordinary water. Go to the sea and fill your tank and go wherever you like. Take your girlfriend to Mathura or what is that? So there's no, what is that? Mahabalipur. All because Rustam got this idea from a shloka in the Yajurveda, which is called Urch, which says, is water is the father of fire. Water is the father of, mother of every energy in this world. Fascinating. And you are 8% by weight water. Okay? But 9% of your molecules are water. So much, whatever happens to water, affects your body. If you are pregnant, delivering during a new moon is difficult. Because your fluid is less. Delivering to you full moon is very easy. So in Europe now, some surgeons have started doing elective surgery new moon time. Because very little blood loss. If you have to do an emergency surgery in full moon time, you lose a lot of blood. So all these things affect a lot of our system. So you are a part of this universe and try to live in you. That's called prakritika jivana. You live with the universe. See, Ayurveda says food is different from summer season, winter season, when it's mother food. Now we have the new modern medical new, which is calorie wise, it calculates, and round the year it's the same. No, Ayurveda says in winter you require more, so eat lot of spices. Switch it. No, you're looking at a watch. Now, basically, after 50 years of researching common cold in a center in London called Cold Research Colindale, from 1948 to 1990, spending $10 billion, they came to the conclusion we can't know anything about common cold at all. So the center is closed, and they have started AIDS research in the same. But the last paper which came out of the Colindale center in the Lancet says, if you get cold season, go to an Indian restaurant and eat lot of curries. And our Ayurveda is in summer, you take lot of seasonings, hot. And now Ziment from Harvard University, best viral killer is ginger. Next is garlic, then is pepper. And mother used to say, whenever you have anything upper respiratory, have a kashaya. But better than kashaya, what I tell my patients is 1 inch of garlic, 3 pods of black pepper, couple of pods of garlic, and a small onion, which I call as sambar onion, vengai sambar onion. And then little jaggery, a rich a teaspoon of honey, put it in the mouth, go on munching till you water from the nose, eyes, mouth, etc. And the enzymes in these waters kill viruses, and the whole thing comes out. Then at the end, you feel like swallowing it, swallow it, because next day it will be good at the other end. So you must have some input to output. Otherwise, constipated, then go to the doctor for so many things. You sit there and everyone mukking, you know, mukking. Mukkar anjur. You go on, and then you get hernia after some time. Then you go to the heart, hernia suffer, hernia or raphi. And then you get piles at the other end. And then sometimes you get even heart attack coming. Really seriously mukkufai. What happens is, you get a serious rise in blood pressure and suddenly it comes down. So you get a heart attack. You will be comfortably meeting your maker in the toilet. That's one way of, you know, exit from here must be made as possible. And modern medicine is giving you a lot of things to give. A good friend of mine, who is no more, may his soul rest in peace. One day he came to me, he's a big professor, he was AICT director, he was a university doctor. He said, Dr. Hegde, it used to be 5 minutes in the toilet for me in the morning, till I went for blood pressure and he gave me so many tablets. Now, even 1 hour, I have no time in the morning, even 1 hour I don't get anything. And you know, small pellets coming out. I was reminded of an incident in my life, which humbled me a lot, which made me feel I am a bloody fool. Then only I read what Mark Twain has written. A wise man knows he is a fool, but a fool thinks he is wise. Up until the time I was a fool, I was thinking very wise. After this girl, I was going to Delhi. There was a new flight called a Bombardier flight to Delhi from, which was taking about 3 hours, nearly 3 hours. And Air India started, they were not giving you any food, no reading material, nothing. That day I had forgotten book also. So I was sitting there, two seats on either side. There was a girl sitting with me. And she was reading a thick book. And she was so absorbed in the book, I was feeling so bored. Plane is flying, nothing happening. Nobody is getting any food, nothing to read. I was jealous of this girl reading the book. So after some time, I just wondered, I said, young lady, do you know relativity theory? She said, yes. What do you want to say? No, I said, if neighbors in the plane start talking, it appears that the plane is going faster. So why not? She was so annoyed because I disturbed her. She said, talk about what, man? She said. I said, look, I have been a teacher for about 45 years now. We can talk about anything. Yes, we'll talk. I see. You talk on anything? I said, I suppose so. She said, I'll ask you a question first. If you answer that, we'll talk. I said, okay. I said, what can this high school ask? So she said, do you know a cow? I said, yes, I do. Do you know a goat? I said, yes, I have seen goats. Do you know a horse? I said, yes. What do they eat? She asked. Good, she said. Now, okay, all of them eat grass. Look at the other end. Cow brings out a large patty. Horse brings out buckets of dried grass. And this goat brings out pellets, small pellets. Tell me why, she said. I scratched my head for a long time. First time in my life I cursed my mother for bringing me to this world. To be humiliated by this girl. Then I said, young lady, I really don't know why it happens. Then she said, because you're right. A man who doesn't know shit wants to talk about other things. And she dipped herself into that book. What was that book? Harry Potter. So, what happens is, people have a lot of problems with the shitty. You may think it is a small thing. You know what shit is? What is shit? Good. Good girl. Store high in transit. S-H-I-T. In the good old days, the manure was not fat or urea. It was human shit. And it was being shipped from one country to another country. And if you put it in below in the shape, it absorbs a lot of water. And if it is 10 tons to begin with, the ship will sink by the time it reaches the other end. It becomes 100 tons. So they said, this must be stored high above, and store high in transit, S-H-I-T, became shit. So she said, a man who doesn't know shit is talking about other things. Absolutely true, you know, how nice it is. But the shitting business in human beings is one of the very important causes of hospitalization. You don't shit properly, then you take all the other things, and ultimately what happens is every day you drink this irritable things, and ultimately it starts leaking. So for years together you would have a baby's, what is that called, Pampers, eh? Pampers, right? Another Pampers thing. Now Kidi has asked a question, old age problem. You are not old at all. Somebody asked me how old I am, I said I don't know. If you ask me when I was born, I know, but I don't know, because I don't want to think about it. Each time somebody says, hey, you know, in the plane and all, they sometimes now, they don't say, hello uncle, they say, you feel a little bad, you know. This elderly lady calling me an uncle, you feel bad. But then I say, no, he must be thinking like that, but I don't. You are as old or as young as you are. The problems of old age are not because of the age, because your children are not with you and they don't look after you. Remember that. I've been talking to old people when I was a student in England also. I once had a lady. She had about so many problems, but her main problem was in the heart. She had heart failure. And she was our main patient, but she had drugs from every doctor, every specialist. She had about 18, 19, 20 drugs. One day I was talking to her. She said, young doctor, do you know my problem? The government is not helping me. The government is spending thousands of pounds of their taxpayers' money for supplying me these drugs. I don't want any one of them. Tell the NHS to give me a ticket to Australia, because my only son has been in Australia for 30 years. He has not come to see me. If they give me one ticket to Australia, if I can see my son, my breathing will be all right. I had tears in my eyes. Today, see elderly people. Hi, Papa. Hi, Mom. And he'll probably, you know, in the Western style, he'll come with a wine bottle in Christmas and say, hi, Pop. Hi, Dad. And then come next Christmas one. You have your people with you. You love one another. I tell you, you don't have any disease at all. I have seen this in practice. I have a family in Manipal. These children are all, three children, are all PhDs from Stanford. They're big jobs in America. They left all that. They said, our parents have become old. We will come back. They came to Manipal, built another floor on their house and started a new company where they're doing very well. But they are with their all the three sons, three wives, their children in one house, father and the mother. The father was very old. He had an illness. Children said, no hospitalization. And they said, sir, you just give us some advice. We will look after him. They did 4 hours duty, 24 hours. By alarm clock, one brother will sit 4 hours, round the clock, next brother will take over, the sister-in-law will take over, another sister-in-law will come, 24 hours. They kept him alive for 8 months without a single tablet and without going to the hospital, and he died a happy man talking to his own people. Today what happens? You are in the intensive care unit, which is hell. In short, it is hell. But intensive care unit is the one that gives you money. American audit showed 90% of the hospital profit comes from keeping dying patients in the intensive care unit for 10 days. Bombay people think a healthy individual is one who is not properly investigated. If you want to know, there's a book. Read this. The Last Well Person. What's the book's name? The Last Well Person. It's a beautiful book. This is written by a professor in America. Professor. I'll tell you the name. Hang on. Comes, it comes. It just can't come like that. It's not. I'll tell you everything. His name is Nortin, N-O-R-T-I-N, Hadler, H-A-D-E-L-E-R. Okay? You want to know who is the publisher? Random House. Now, if you read this book, Professor Hadler will tell you, there is nobody called a well person at all. You are a healthy person by my definition. You go to a doctor, you will be declared ill. Because what is normality in medicine, do you know? Average. Average is called normal. This is statistical medicine. You say your blood pressure was 120 by 80. Who said that? My blood pressure cannot be like your blood pressure, her blood pressure. Each one of us has different blood pressure. I'll give you an example. We have one Varma who started the NIMHANS in Bangalore. He was the founder director of NIMHANS, whose blood pressure always is 90 by 40. And he has been seeing me for a number of years for treatment. I said, look, you will live for 100 years. Why are you worried about it? And he operates for 12 hours standing. He is about 90 years now. Even now he is a consultant. And Mahatma Gandhi's blood pressure is 240 by 120. Who was not getting sleep? Sushila Nair. You read Sushila Nair's biography. She was worried that the old man will, kick his bucket any minute. And he died of hypertensive complication. That's a bullet from Godse. What does it mean? We are not averages. I'll give you a much more mundane example. What is the normal Indian height for men or women? 5.4 plus minus 2. This is called median plus 2 standard deviation. That's a statistical jargon. You know what statistics is? There are three kinds of lies. Ordinary lies, which ordinary people like you and me speak. When the phone rings, you don't want to take it, you tell your wife he's eating. Then super lies, which politicians speak. George Orwell's Animal Farm, he says, they will give respectability to murder. They will solidify the air, and they will promise a bridge where there is no river also. That is super lies. Then the third is statistics. You can make anything to anything. You give same biodata which our friend Basu read. If you give it to some good lawyer, he will say BM Hegde is the first criminal who must be hanged before that kasab or whatever. But if you give it to Basu, he'll say BM Hegde is so good that he must be given Bharat Ratna. Both are possible. Because what is statistics? You dredge it, you sharpshoot it, you mix masters. And there's a beautiful book called Science Without Sense. That is statistics. You want the author, madam? Stephen Milloy. The author's name is Stephen Milloy. And the book's name is Science Without Sense. And the publisher is Cato Institute, Washington. Write down. 1000 Massachusetts Avenue, Washington, D.C., 2001. What I am saying is, we live in a fool's world, and we are all schooled to believe that these doctors are all gods, they are here for our good. There are gods among doctors. But Ayurveda has also said, doctor, when you start getting money, Vaidhyarajo Namastubhyam, I salute you. Why? Yamaraja Sahodara, you are the brother of Yamaraja. Don't feel bad. I am very proud because Yamaraja is the only man who is not corrupt and who treats everyone equally. Absolutely equally. So it's proud. But the second sentence is a little tricky. Yamastu harati pranan. Yama only takes life. Vaidhyo pranan dhananicha. You take both. This is the problem. So otherwise, then so much so, doctors have lost all their credibility even in the West now. I was telling Nadkarni Saab, you must all read this article. It is free in the internet, called Death by Medicine. Read that, Death by Medicine. The first author's name, madam, is Gary Null. This is in a very difficult journal. You won't get it in the journal because you have to pay for it. but it's free in the internet. Somebody has put it in the internet. Virus, put it in the internet. Read it in the, and you will get real good idea. If you want to read a respectable scientific journal itself, there's an article called "Is US Medicine the Best in the World?" Read it. Is US, United States medicine the best in the world? Okay, article. Author's name is Barbara, B-A-R-B-A-R-B-A-R-A. Barbara, you know? Barbara Starfield, S-T-A-R-F-I-E-L-D, Starfield. And the journal is freely available on the internet. It's called JAMA, J-A-M-A, Journal of the American Medical Association. Year is 2000, write down 2000. Semicolon, volume is 284. Colon, page is 483. Go and read that today. You will get a shock. American medicine is the worst in the world, and we are aping American medicine. Number one. Number two, America, doctors and medicines are the leading cause of death. You get that? And cancer and heart attack come after that. Still, we want to be American. Today, the craze for America is such that I was telling the doctors in Hinduja Hospital this morning, today if you want to go for a consultant's this interview, you must have one special qualification. You may be a FRCS, MRCS, nothing. BTA, you know what BTA is? Been to America. Unless you have gone to America for training for at least 1 year, you are not the ideal candidate for appointment as a consultant. So everybody is there, you know, 10 candidates sitting, everybody is anxious whether there is only one post vacant. They say, are you a BTA? Are you a BTA? If anybody is BTA, this fellow will not go for the interview at all. He'll go home. If nobody is a BTA, then he says, I stand a chance. Let me try. So that is our, because we are slaves. We have political independence, but not intellectual independence. We still think with the Western idea. See, yoga originally is from India. It has gone to America and come back. Now you have super yoga. Have you seen super yoga in the internet? How many Tamilians here? Huh? You know Topukaranam? When you go to Pillayar temple, you do pandringa. This Topukaranam today in the internet has become super yoga, because actually Topukaranam is done for a particular reason. When you do that and pull your pinna down, it directly stimulates your hippocampus major. So if you are going for an exam, or here, before coming here, I wanted to Topukaranam, but Sucheta, I saw Sucheta and forgot to put Topukaranam. Otherwise, I would have spoken better, sensible things. I'm talking nonsense because I didn't do Topukaranam. You go to the YouTube and say Topukaranam, you will get that. It's called super yoga. Then you say, ah, it's good. But if you say you do yoga, yoga. So it must come from the, we say in Kannada, any Kannadigas here? Shankadinda Bandra Tirtha. You know, if you give the holy water from the temple in any other form, they don't. But if you put it in the Shankar, then it's real Tirtha. So American medicine is a Topukaranam medicine, gets transferred here. Don't believe that. Now friends, I will tell you what I've been telling you, because De Vellera said, if you want to sell an audience an idea, first tell them what you are going to tell them, which I told you. Then tell them. You can tell for any number of days. I can go on for another 2 days. But he said, don't forget to tell them what you told them at the end so that they can take it home. Three things I told you. A, you are born to be healthy till you die. Don't try to live here forever. You will not succeed, said Bernard Shaw in his book, Doctor's Dilemma. Okay? So don't try to be here forever. Your aim should be, till I die, I should be healthy so that I don't become dependent on others. Don't be dependent on others. Think that your children will look after you, your wife will look after you, your husband will look after you. When you are severely disabled, after some time they all get fed up. Psychological inside they will be thinking, when will this fellow die? But outside they will say, no, we will do everything. I have experience. You know, we get these old people in the village whose children are in America. So this fellow, old man, 80 years old man, gets a heart attack. He's admitted in my intensive care unit. Night 2 o'clock, I get a phone call. Till then, I was looking after his father. When I come and want to sleep, doctor, my father is admitted under you in so-and-so. I said, yes. How is he? Well, he has had a serious heart attack. We will try, but you know, we don't know. I don't know. God knows what will happen. But doctor, money is no problem. You do anything you want. I want my father alive. Then you tell him, I wish money could keep somebody alive. No, we will do our best with or without money. But then ultimately what happens to him depends on God. So you think he is going to die, doctor? Supposing I say, because he wants me to say he will die. Because he knows he will die, but he doesn't want to say that. He wants the guilt feeling passed on to the doctor. Supposing I say, chances are that he will die. But doctor, you better tell me in advance because I have only 10 days holidays. I want to finish all the work when you come back. Which means he wants him to die. He does not want the guilt feeling. So he said, money, no problem. He thinks he can give love for money. I tell such people, if you come here and spend those 10 days now, maybe your father will not die. But then he's afraid, supposing he dies at the end of 10 days, he can't stay back. This is the problem. So don't depend on others. That must be your aim in life. To do that, A, think of compassion. Don't hate nobody. Don't hurt nobody. Don't even have an ill feeling towards somebody. And don't allow anybody to insult you, because nobody can insult you without your permission. What is insult? If you think you are somebody, you know, you are a tiger. Occasionally somebody thinks you are a monkey, then they say he's a monkey. Then you get terribly angry. You know you are a monkey, but you are acting as a tiger. But if you are a monkey and you accept you are a monkey, somebody calls you monkey, fine. That's what he has found. So be who you are. Most of us live a different life. Don't live on your reputation. Reputation is what the world thinks. Live on yourself, your character. Character is what you are. And I know what I am, and I don't want to live as what Basu said I am. You know, I am. So I know my frailties, my weaknesses, my strong points, etc., etc. You are happy. Otherwise, on the day somebody insults you, you have headache. Your blood pressure goes up. You go to the doctor. Then you check up. Check up means you are a patient. You're a patient means you don't come back. And that's what happens to you. So don't do that. Live comfortably. Number three, eat natural food in moderation. Simple thing is, can I eat this doctor? Can I eat that doctor? That contains cholesterol doctor. That will kill you. Eat what you like, but in moderation. I'll give you a simple formula, Chinese formula. I drink when I'm thirsty. I eat when I'm hungry. If the heavens don't fall down, I'll certainly live till I die. Do you get that formula? And then third very important thing is sleep well. And how much should one sleep? I don't know. You may want to sleep for 10 hours. I may want to sleep for 4 hours. It's individualized. But on an average about 6 to 7 hours, 8 hours is good. But don't sleep more than 9 hours because your lifespan comes down. Your muscles degenerate. You're not made to sleep. And don't sleep when the sun is up. Don't sleep when the sun is up. Your sleep rhythm starts only when the sun goes down. Our ancestors used to sleep when the sun goes down because they had no light. And they wake up before the sun comes up because the light comes before the sun comes up. When the birds start chirping. That's the time the sun has already risen somewhere. But what happens today in Bombay, there is no night at all. There's no night at 24 hours, there's light. Probably night has more light than daytime. And these artificial lights are very bad. In your sleeping room, don't have any electronic gadget on. The electromagnetic energy is bad for you. You don't have even the switch on of a television, which is switched from your, you know, bed. No, switch it off. And don't keep a mobile phone for charging at night. No. Don't have any switch on. Don't want dirty electricity effect on you. Do you know if you go to a laboratory with so many computers there and so much of connections there, so many cell phones, give your blood 200 blood sugar, you go to Maidan, stay for about 4 hours, then call the man there to take your blood, it is 120. That is the effect of these electromagnetic gadgets on you. So don't sleep with that. Number three, don't sleep with any light coming to your bedroom. It must be pitch dark. The darker it is, the sleeper comfortable is the sleep. Lot of people say snoring is bad, but I think everyone snores. People who snore don't know because only their wives know they snore. And I was one of my students one day told me in the class, sir, why do you think they call it a sound sleep? His argument was very interesting. He says, unless you make sound, you are not very, very sleep, deep sleep. Very good idea, no? Very good idea. Anyway, so that's the one thing about sleeping. Last thing is, don't overeat at night. Last food must be before sunset. Then you can take any number of hours to sleep, but don't eat after the sun sets. The Jain system is very healthy. Jain system is very healthy. Okay, na? See, she knows. She knows. And you eat like a king in the morning. Your breakfast must be. You eat like a commoner at lunchtime. Eat like a pauper at night. So small. And smaller frequent meals would be very nice if you are a diabetic or a hypertensive. Small, small feeds. I say 6 feeds. 8:30, 10:30, 12:30, 3:30, 6:30, 9:30. 3 of them must be small meals. 3 of them must be fruit. Eat as much fruit and vegetables you like. If I can request you, be a vegetarian, because there are 6,000 articles saying that cooked meat is one of the very important causes of cancer. But that you don't get to read because the cancer industry suppresses it. And why do you want to make your stomach a burial ground for animals? Just eat vegetarian food which is good for you. Not that vegetables don't have life, they also have life, but the cycle is different. They don't have the kind of emotions that we have. Their consciousness is something different. You read J.C. Bose, plant consciousness and human consciousness, something different. You will be surprised. In the West, people don't even believe that plants have consciousness. I was giving a lecture in the Royal College in London where I mentioned about this consciousness and talking. A very senior fellow afterwards wrote a letter to me saying that, what were you talking through your hat? Plants can't have consciousness. So I sent him all the data. Then he says, my God, I never realized that I am such an ignoramus till I read your papers. But let me tell you, all the others who are listening were also ignoramuses like. That's a very interesting thing. Now, last thing is work. Samikshakari says Ayurveda, work very hard. But work must be one you love. Don't do any work which you hate. You will die faster. Love your work, you will live long. And don't think simply sitting is bad. Sitting is very bad. Sitting alone can kill about 60% of people. Just doing nothing, sitting. Man is not meant for sitting. What you can do sitting, do it standing. What you can do standing, do it walking. And the best exercise for the day is walking. This is the only one that reduces 80% of a risk for death, premature death. Walking has been now found to be the one risk factor remover for 80% of the precocious deaths. Not running, not jogging, not playing the kind of sports that our people play on the television. It is killing. The harder, the more exercise you make, more damage to the heart occurs. And so, last but not the least, love everyone. You will live forever. And so beautifully put by Ayurveda. Nitya, Hita, Mita, Ahara, Sevi. That's understood. Samikshakari, which means work hard. Data, be a giver, not a taker. Because when you give, you become God. What's the difference with God and man? God gives and gives and gives and forgives. Man gets and gets and gets and forgets. So if you just become, instead of a getter, giver, you become. Then what says? Samaha, treat everyone as equal. Satyapara, don't cheat, don't do all that. What Subramanya Swami is fighting against, don't do that. Last, Kshamavan. You may say, I won't hurt anybody. Somebody might hurt you. You forgive him. He doesn't know, poor man. What is there? I'll forgive him. That's the most important thing. Forgiveness. And even the Western philosophy, you see Rudyard Kipling wrote in the poem, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, you shall be a man, my son, and more, this earth shall belong to you. What a beautiful thing. And he says more, if you can walk with the kings, but still keep your common touch. If you can mix with the crowd, but still keep your virtue. So what a beautiful thing. So all these things are good health. Lastly, it says, Aptopasevi bhavet arogyam. Treat everyone as your near and dear ones. You will be healthy till you die. Thank you very much.